woman has finally won the pole position at the Daytona 500.
Yes, I saw that.
Danica Patrick.
I saw that.
Drove that rascal at over 195 miles an hour.
I can't imagine. Well, you had an experience with driving there.
I drove 30 laps down at Charlotte, but they had a governor on my car. I couldn't get it over 145 miles an hour.
The governor's good.
Well, I wanted to go faster. I kept flooring the thing, and that was just all I could get. The other thing is, protest in Washington today is going to be a wind chill of 18, and hardy souls are protesting global warming.
Sense has flown to the wind.
Sense has flown to the wind. They're going to be cold up there. All right. I wrote a book on it. I really am thinking about republishing The End of the Age, but this one came out of nowhere. It was the biggest meteor to hit Earth in more than 100 years, and it blew up over Russia Friday, and no one saw it coming.
Well, now the United Nations, Congress, and scientists are asking, how can we find these deadly space rocks before they strike our planet and cause untold damage? Heather Sells has the story.
The meteor that exploded over Russia carried the explosive force of 20 to 30 Hiroshima bombs. And only hours after the meteor hit Russia, a 150-foot asteroid missed Earth by only 17,000 miles. NASA says there was no connection between the two, but it raises the specter of the threat that asteroids can pose to Earth. Experts say this could be a cosmic warning shot and a reminder to continue to invest in space science.
20 years ago, if DA-14 flew by the Earth, we would have never known it.
The UN and the House Science, Space, and Technology Committee announced plans to investigate the threat of asteroids to Earth. When former NASA astronaut is already developing a plan to detect asteroids, it's a deep space telescope called Sentinel, and it could give Earth decades of advance warning when something major is heading our way.
With 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years of notice, it's actually pretty straightforward to deflect an asteroid.
Liu says his project will cost about $450 million. He's hoping to raise the money through public donations. And he says it's a small price to pay when you think of the alternative. Officials estimate it will cost over $33 million to repair damage from the Russian meteor.
How could we let our civilization or parts of our civilization or huge parts of our cities or whatever go away, be destroyed, if we could have done something about it?
Heather Sells, CBN News.
Well, I wrote a book called The End of the Age because I believe the prophecy that was given by Jesus Christ will be fulfilled almost verbatim only by an asteroid strike on Earth. And it'll be a horrible thing to contemplate. And it is, I wrote about the devastation of what would happen to one that was a half a mile, just a half a mile in diameter, and what it did to the whole Earth. And there are 5 million hunks of rocks around the orbit of the Earth. They're out there, 5 million of them. And this one.
It was pretty. I thought what was most fascinating about your book was that you had done all the scientific backup behind it.
That's
of
right.
The impact that would have. We don't realize what would happen to the Earth if something like that.
Well, it
struck.
Shakes the crust. You have tsunamis of great force. Mine, I had it hit off the coast of California in the Pacific Ocean, and what it did to Asia is extraordinary. But we just have no idea the explosive force. Mine was 3 billion pounds, and I figured it out. And I say mine, but I just think it fulfills Bible prophecy. I may bring that book out again because it was so timely in today's world. And the big thing was people ignored it in the science community. They refused to appropriate the necessary money to take care of it. I have a correction in my ear. There is a producer. The producer said it was not 18 degrees in Washington. It was 16 degrees. And they said the march for against global warming in that 16-degree weather, wind chill, was yesterday, not today. So they may have another one today, but yesterday was today. Mm-hmm. We've got to take care of global warming, especially in the snowstorms. Well, one of the nation's leading surgeons got a great deal of attention when he spoke out about health care and taxes recently at a presidential prayer breakfast. Now he's explaining why he made those remarks. Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom. Lee.
Pat, Dr. Ben Carson says he asked God to show him what to say before he made his speech at this month's National Prayer Breakfast in Washington. Carson spoke while President Obama was just two seats away. Carson questioned higher taxes on people who make more money, and he talked about a simpler flat tax, like the idea of the tithe from the Bible. He also talked about handling health care far differently than the president's Obamacare plan. So far, his speech has gotten more than 2 million views on YouTube and catapulted his book, America the Beautiful, to the top of Amazon's bestseller list. Critics say Carson's remarks were too political for a prayer breakfast. But on ABC's This Week, he said there's another reason for the strong reaction.
I make of it the fact that before I gave that talk, I prayed and asked God to give me wisdom, what to say, what would resonate, what would be important. And, you know, I don't think it was particularly political.
When asked for his opinion on President Obama, Dr. Carson said he's a very talented politician. As for his own political aspirations, Pat, he said, I leave that up to God.
On one of the blogs, they're saying Carson for president. They just think it was a tremendous speech. You know, this man has been on the board of trustees at Regent University for a number of years. He's a distinguished man, an extraordinary story. His mother was illiterate. He didn't know it. And his mother said to her young son, you will read 3 books a week, and you will write me book reviews. And so they read the books and wrote the book reviews and handed them in to the mother, not knowing the mother couldn't read what they were writing. Well, as a result of that, he moved to the top of his class, wound up going to Yale, and then he went to distinguished medical school. I mean, it's an extraordinary story. He was director of pediatric neurosurgery at Johns Hopkins University and was the first man to operate on conjoined twins, twins that were joined at the head.
The head of all places.
Nobody had ever done that. And I said, how did you figure it out? He said, well, I froze them. They actually lowered the temperature to keep the blood from flowing. And then he did that delicate surgery. Extraordinary.
I've been in his home and interviewed him. He's one of the most humble people I think I've ever met. Whole family.
He says he has over 50 honorary doctorates. I mean, he's just extraordinary. And he's so humble. But boy, he did lay it out on the president. Lee, speak out with boldness like Dr. Carson.
All right, here's another story, Pat. A new study indicates better television equals better behavior among children. The study suggests that changing the channel from violent to educational TV can improve the behavior of preschoolers. The study comes from the Seattle Children's Research Institute. It shows the improvement is modest and fades over time, but lead author Dr. Dimitri Kostakis says it proves that what children watch is as important as how much they watch. The White House is downplaying an immigration plan that was leaked to the media Saturday. They say it's only a backup measure in case Congress cannot come up with a plan of its own. The measure would create visas for those who are in the country illegally, and it would let them become legal residents within 8 years. It would also add more funding for border security. Republicans attacked the plan, however. Florida Senator Marco Rubio says if the president actually proposes the bill, it would be dead on arrival in Congress. And others wonder if the president is simply playing politics with immigration.
By giving advantage to those who cut in front of line for immigrants who came here legally, not dealing with border security adequately, that tells us that he's looking for a partisan advantage.
Does the president really want a result, or does he want another cudgel to beat up Republicans?
McCain says the White House needs to give senators a chance to finish their own plan. Concern over new gun control laws in this country has led to a run on ammunition and a nationwide shortage. And as Andrea Garrett reports, that's led to a concern about public safety.
Local police departments are having a hard time finding bullets to fill their guns. Some worry it could lead to a dangerous shortage that could affect the way law enforcement agents do their jobs.
We were issued a box a month so that we could go practice on our own. We no longer get that simply because the ammo's not there for it to make it available.
40 caliber bullets are the kind most often used in police training. A 50-round box used to cost about $30, but in the wake of the Newtown, Connecticut shooting, demand is up, which means suppliers are raising prices as well.
Along with these tragic incidents that happen, the fear of what's going to happen with the government comes into play, and then people react to that.
And increased prices aren't the only concern. Some agencies are placing orders for ammo and being forced to wait months for it to arrive.
I think as long as the gun control issue is dominating the media and dominating our country right now, it's going to get worse. The rounds will be fewer to find.
Andrea Garrett, CBN News.
And we're told that gun stores are also running short of common types of ammunition, and prices have gone much higher. One gun shop owner in North Carolina tells USA Today, "We are absolutely in uncharted territory. Our store is 53 years old, and we have never seen anything like this. People feel this administration is very anti-gun, and they're going for the legal gun owner." The president says, though, that he doesn't want to violate gun owners' constitutional rights. Four foreign Christian workers in Libya have been arrested on suspicion of spreading Christianity and giving out Christian literature. Preaching the gospel is against the law in the mostly Muslim nation. A police spokesman says one of the suspects is a Swedish American. The others are from South Africa, Egypt, and South Korea. Police arrested them Tuesday and confiscated some 45,000 books. Another 25,000 books were reportedly distributed. Christian missionary and healing evangelist T.L. Osborne has died. His daughter posted news of his death on Twitter after he passed away Thursday. She said he was in no pain and had no sickness. The Lord simply took his breath away. Osborne established Osborne Ministries with his wife Daisy in 1949. Their ministry reached more than 100 nations and had daily meetings that featured up to 300,000 people. His ministry's motto was "One Way, Jesus." One job, evangelism. But Osborne also experienced his share of grief. Three of his children died prematurely, and his wife Daisy died in his arms. He talked about that experience on the 700 Club.
Discouragement and depression, oppression. It is a matter of the thoughts that we choose to retain. Mm-hmm. If we think depressing thoughts, we'll be depressed. I had to change my way of thinking. Instead of lamenting Daisy's death and being gone from me, I said to myself, wait, this isn't helping me and it won't help anybody else. So I changed my thoughts and remember. I drew from my memory bank and remembered when she was with me. Mm-hmm. And so I comfort myself. God comforts me, but you got to take control.
T.L. Osborne was 89 years old. Pat, I know you enjoyed interviewing him, and you called him a friend.
Oh, a dear friend. He's a wonderful man. I tell you, the miracles that man had, and his books were so inspiring. He would go in and preach Jesus, and he would talk about the power of Jesus, and as he did, thousands had miraculous healings. Amputated limbs grew, and crippled people stood up straight, and all kinds of cancers fell off. It was just unbelievable what was attended that man. But he had a visitation of Jesus, and he was his servant. So we lament the fact, but he was 89 years old, and I guess the time comes that people die. Mm-hmm.
But he was a great man of God, and many, many nations of the earth were.
Well, overseas, unbelievable,
work.
And he had a ministry to the gypsies. He'd been very active in Africa, but he got over in Asia and was just a complete failure, and he was trying to be theological, and he came back and he had an experience with Jesus, and the Lord said, look, preach the gospel. Don't talk about all this stuff. Don't talk about various theological doctrines. Just preach the gospel. And he went out and did it, and oh man, well, we miss him, but the great giants of the faith, they come like these meteors, and then they go, and the Lord raises up somebody else. Well, we'll be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Several states are considering legalizing physician-assisted suicide. Advocate groups like Compassion and Choice have been working to push the cause. especially as a large number of baby boomers are beginning to face end-of-life issues. Bills legalizing assisted suicide are being considered in Connecticut, Vermont, New Jersey, Kansas, Hawaii, and Massachusetts. And bills related to the issue are being considered in New Hampshire, New York, Arizona, and Montana. CBN continues to bring the gospel to India. More than 160,000 people tune into a CBN program called Nrikshana, which means hope. The number one news channel in India airs the program. Nrikshana is a magazine format ministry program that shares God's love through testimonies, ministry, and prayer. India is less than 3% Christian, but each month CBN receives about 6,000 calls from viewers of the program. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.